Good morning.
Good morning.
Wow, nice to see everybody. You're all way back there. That's okay. We're used to that. We only clean those seats, actually, just the only ones that we disinfect. So good seating there. Really nice to see everybody. God bless you. We're going to just start out with a couple of worship songs here, and maybe we'll start out with a little prayer, huh? Thank you, Lord. Lord, we're grateful to be here today that you have sustained this place, this little church in a little town, for a place to encourage and bring hope and at times, difficult times for folks, and a place where people that are joyful for what you're doing in their lives can come and celebrate that. I thank you, Lord. Bless us in all these understandings, Lord, and receive our praise and our adoration and our worship in the many forms, Lord God, as we sing to you today. Bless us in these things, we ask in your name. Amen.
There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen. Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where the streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, when I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing
praise your name today and every day of our lives, Lord Jesus. We praise your name. You who have gone to a cross to die for our sins so that we could live in eternity with you, Lord God, bless you. Bless your name. The name that is above all names, Lord God, and the name that spells love and peace and life forever. Bless us in these understandings, we ask in your precious name, Lord God. And again, we pray that prayer that you taught the disciples, Lord. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. Forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Pick a song. Just a little different since June's not with us. Everybody had one when she was here. I still look at my passenger seat on Saturday night and think, I better get that clutter off there. No, guess I don't need to. Yeah. Miss June. We're going to read from the responsive psalm, and it's Psalm 26, 1 through 8. Give judgment for me, O Lord, for I have lived with integrity. I have trusted in the Lord and have not faltered. Test me, O Lord, and try me. Examine my heart and my mind. For your steadfast love is before my eyes. I have walked faithfully with you. I have not sat with the worthless, nor do I consort with the deceitful. I have hated the company of evildoers. I will not sit down with the wicked. I will wash my hands in innocence, O Lord, that I may go in procession round your altar. Singing aloud a song of thanksgiving and recounting all your wonderful deeds. Lord, I love the house in which you dwell and the place where your glory abides. I know you know how much I love the scripture from 1 Peter. For God wishes that not one would be lost. It's one of those clues to God's heart. You know, God ultimately judges, and he's given us the rule book, but God wishes that not one would be lost. So you won't ever hear me pronounce it's just too late for this person or that person. You'll never hear me say that. But my good friend Pastor Steve here pointed me to a scripture in 2 Thessalonians that should give you pause. Last week when I left here, I looked at the Facebook page, and one of his parishioners who'd been to his church had posted Pastor Steve, and from Pastor Steve's sermon today, 2020 isn't the year for casual Christianity. So I got him on the phone and talked to him a little bit because I like that. The scripture in 2 Thessalonians, and the Greek backs this up, it's from the Message version, which is very, very word friendly. It says, the Antichrist's coming is all Satan's work. All his power, signs, and miracles are fake, evil, sleight of hand that plays to the gallery, of those who hate the truth. What's the truth? Jesus, God sent his only son into the world to so that if we believed in him and come to God, that we would be saved forever and everything from there. It plays to the gallery of those who hate the truth that could save them. And since they're so obsessed with evil, God gives them what they want. Since they refuse to trust truth, they are banished to their chosen world of lies and illusions. That's the Message version. God has laid down the markers, but he will not hijack yours or my free will. Interesting, huh? So we give up on the knuckleheads that matter to us? No. Oh. Come at them incessantly? You got to just... It never worked for me. Never worked on me. No, we live our lives in a way that honors Jesus and garners respect, makes us trustworthy, and thereby allows them, those who we would love to see in eternity, to wish to live more nobly. We don't go along to get along. We can't make holiness matter to people who have been deluded if we behave like people who have no God. We just affirm their tragic choice to snub God. Tupos is a word from the Greek meaning impression or stamp or pattern. Tupos. Tupos, you know, when you hit something with a die and it leaves a mark, that's a tupos. The Hebrews used a tupos, a pattern, to teach their children the alphabet. So it had cutouts so they could mark the words, the letters. They could make the letters and the words. The Hebrews used it for that. Adam is referred as a tupos or example. And we are called to exemplify our Lord Jesus Christ in word and deed, leaving his stamp on the people that we encounter in our workplace or in our day-to-day. And all Jesus is asking of us is to love him back enough to listen, obey, make love a priority, and to walk with him in our day-to-day. And Romans 12:9-21. Jesus asks this of us. Let love be genuine, Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you, and bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those. And I got to say, that's a tough one. Bless those who curse you or persecute you. It's real easy to curse them, said the pastor. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim, in other words, the poor. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. And take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live peacefully with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, God says. I will repay, says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they're thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Now we'll talk about that. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Did you ever catch your hair on fire? Probably not. I did. It gets your attention. Yeah. I was putting a match out, lit a cigarette, and my hair was down on my shoulders. And it sounded like a forest fire when my hair caught fire. It sounded, you know, like, you know, like it sounds like on TV. And the guy next to me started batting me in the head. He said, your hair is on fire. It'll get your attention. It makes, it will heap, in so doing, you will heap burning coals on their heads. That isn't to shame them. Our enemies expect retribution when they're evil with us or when they're ugly with us. When we love them, they're most likely to snap out of their delusion and see the one who lives in us, you or me, loves them too. That's a lot of times how people are won to the Lord. It's not with somebody saying, sit down, or any of that at all, but if somebody saying, okay, I understand that you're mad at me, but let's talk about that. And, you know, I'm not mad at you, and let's talk. That's what reaches people. And when you bless somebody that is enjoying abusing you, that's the best opportunity for, besides handcuffs and jail, that's the best opportunity for them to say, what about this? For the light to come on. Jesus, who alone can save their soul, can reach them. We can only see this and be this when we're willing to live like Jesus instead of like everybody else. Jeremiah 15, I want to talk about that, and we'll read through Jeremiah 15 kind of piece by piece, and I'll give a little commentary on each part of it. Honesty with Jesus is paramount. Getting there and remaining honest is its own challenge. God will not hijack our free will. He's either the greatest source of hope and love in our life, or we're still holding out, because God doesn't hold out. Jeremiah is honest about what he is feeling, and that's when God responds to him, reassuringly, directly, lovingly, mercifully. Jeremiah is called to be the prophet to his countrymen in the country that he loves. And he's prophesying to them, and they're not listening. They're not paying attention. He's praying to God that they'll get it, and praying that God will forgive them in the immediate time. And he's getting frustrated because he's not seeing it going in the direction of God saying, okay, your sins are forgiven, because the people aren't apologizing. Okay? They're living like they ought not. They're abusing others. And Jeremiah is at his wit's end. He finds no peace. I'll just break this up, and I'm going to read a part of it, and then I'm going to kind of translate it for you here. O Lord, you know, remember me and visit me and bring down retribution for me on my persecutors. They were hating him because he was telling them the truth. In your forbearance, do not take me away. Know that on your account I suffer insult. In our words, Lord, you know me, you know all things. What am I missing here? I need you to have my back. This is much, much harder than expected. In verse 16, your words were found, I ate them, and your words became to me a joy and delight of my heart. For I am called by your name, O Lord God of hosts. I followed my heart to follow you, Lord. I delight in truth, but your people hate me for this. Now I'm weary of their vengeance and of your silence. In verse 17, I did not sit in the company of merrymakers, nor did I rejoice. Under the weight of your hand, I sat alone, for you had filled me with indignation for such things. Why is my pain unceasing, my wound incurable, refusing to be healed? I refused to live in their ways out of the devotion and honor to you, Lord. I sat alone, hating the sin of those you care for. But now I feel apart from the revelers and apart from you, Lord. I feel quite alone and sad. Truly, you are to me like a deceitful brook, like waters that fail. I pray for them, but you do not answer the prayer. I find no peace. Help me. Therefore, thus says the Lord, if you turn back, I will take you back, and you shall stand before me. Give me your whole heart, Jeremiah. Commit to this mission fully. Though my judgment be a sadness to you, rid your heart of doubt. If you utter what is precious and not what is worthless, you shall serve as my mouth, God said. Speak my truth again, Jeremiah. Bring the willing from the wicked to be redeemed. My ways are not your ways. Judgment has come to these that you serve. In verse 19 through 20 and 21, it is they who will return to you, God says, not you who will return to them. And I will make you to this people a fortified wall of bronze. They will fight against you, but they shall not prevail over you, for I am with you to save you and deliver you, says the Lord. I will deliver you out of the hand of the wicked and redeem you from the grasp of the ruthless. One by one, two by two, some will heed my truth through you, Jeremiah, if you will stay the course of truth. I will make you a wall of bronze impervious to their schemes or actions. Speak my truth and trust me, and I will be there with you. Together we shall prevail. God's good news to Jeremiah and to us. The takeaways are, discouragement comes, but God is doing something profound. I'm discouraged when I see people burning down an innocent person's business. I'm discouraged. I'm saddened for them. I'm discouraged. I'm frustrated with the people that are deluded and doing such a thing. But I know in my heart, if they are trusting God, He is doing something profound for them. Second, God's mercies are new every morning, regardless of what today is like. Lay your head down, get your rest, and know that His mercies are new the next day. If you're feeling bad about the way you acted today, tomorrow is a new day, and God's mercies are new every morning. Third, He remembers that we are formed of dust. God doesn't forget that we're not as smart as Him, that we're created, He's the creator. He doesn't forget that. So there's a build-in there of grace for us. He doesn't forget that we're formed of dust. Fourth, from Ecclesiastes, He is making everything beautiful in its time. God is making everything beautiful in its time. Whatever's ugly today, He's making things beautiful in their time. And five is just kind of a takeoff on that. Never rush the beautician. I want to show a video here. God, Jesus, when He walked the earth, He saw us with the heart of God. He saw us through the lens He was 100% man and 100% God. He saw us through the lens of the Creator. He is our Creator as well. And sometimes we have to look with our heart to get past the of something. I want you to do that here. This is something that I was profoundly touched by because I saw what was going on here for a myriad of people. Lord, help us to see with our hearts the beauty that you inspire around us in this world. Sometimes it's something that we don't want to look at, or something that we have to calm down to understand. But I thank you, Lord, that you open the eyes of our hearts, not just to celebrate you each day, Lord, or to worship you or to read the Bible, but to see you in the places where we didn't expect to. Thank you, Lord. I thank you that you have not given up on us, and we sure haven't given up on you, Lord. But draw us near. Be the shield over us that makes us impervious to the delusion and the illusion of the enemy. Keep us ever mindful of your grace, Lord, that you didn't come into this world to condemn, but to woo us back and to sustain us for the day of our departure to be with you forever. And I thank you for that. I thank you for my friends here, Lord. We love all of these that have come, Lord, and we love each other. And I thank you. You've kept this place afloat so that we can be here when we can be here. Bless us in these things, Lord, and go with and look after each person that's here today. Give them traveling mercies. My friend who works so hard at farming and raising bulls and everything else in the world, keep him safe, Lord. He works awful hard around a lot of crazy equipment. Denise, as she faces a very busy week. Karen, as she goes back to look after those who desperately need healing. And Tony, as he provides us with good French fries. Thank you, Lord. Bless us in these many things and more. Thank you for our sister, as you've blessed her with more work now that she's back. And whoever I've left out, Lord, you know who they are. Thank you. Thank you for everyone here, Lord God. We pray this in your precious name, Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Lord, we lift up Todd Reedman and his family right now. We're claiming a miracle for him and total healing, because we know that you are all-powerful, all-seeing, all-knowing, and you can work this and be glorified in his healing. These are a family of godly believers who love you and who believe in miracles, and we're just claiming this for them. Give them all your strength and peace as they navigate this hard journey that they're going through right now. It's been ups and downs and a lot of waiting, which is hard for us humans. So I just ask that you be with them, and I'd ask my friends here to, anytime you think of them, just lift them up in prayer, because they are feeling it, and just be with them in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Lord, Heavenly Father, that nothing's too big for you, God. With all of us, everything is impossible, but with you, God, mighty God, nothing is. So, Lord, for everyone down in Louisiana, even in Arkansas and Texas, that have just come through one horrific storm, God, you are the God of all our storms. You are our shelter. You are our refuge. You are the strong tower that we all run to, Lord. And you are a big, big, big God. So, Lord, I just ask for your presence down there. Miracles, Lord. Miracles of lives saved. Lord, I ask you to be there. the hands and the feet and the heart through many people that are just giving time and what they have to give for the first responders, Lord, that are going out, those that are clearing the road so that they can even get out to even find and rescue, Lord. So, Lord, I can't imagine 103 degrees humidity and high temps with no air conditioning, no running water, no homes, towns, St. Charles, that are just completely leveled. Lord, the enemy wants to destroy our hope and our faith and just beat us down. But, Lord, you carry us. You're the lifter of our heads. So, Lord, just touch these people. Be their strength. Be their courage. Let them give you thanks and praise for just life, Lord, and what you are doing. And Lord, touch hearts to lift them up and show us how we can help, Lord, way up here to way down there. Your ways are higher than ours, Lord. You're doing a mighty, mighty, mighty revival here through the whole world. And I thank you that you are touching hearts. And even though it says devastating to us, it isn't to you, Lord. You see the big picture. So I praise you. I thank you. And help us, Lord. Help us how we can help our brothers and sisters down south. In your mighty, healing, loving, powerful name, Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Was written on the deck of a large ocean liner. The captain found the man in his room and said, we're going to stall the engines right here. This is where the ship went down and your family perished. They had died about 10 days before that. And so this daddy who'd lost half of his family, actually, most of his kids, went to the up on the deck and they said, "We'll just leave you time here by yourself." And he got pencil and pen and he wrote, "When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever the lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul." Let's sing that first verse one more time.
It is well with my soul.